Thank you for joining our broadcast today. We want you to be free to hear from God, and we pray that His blessing would be on your life. We're a church that's on mission across the aisle, across the street, and around the world. We believe the gospel changes everything. God bless you.
Majestic is your name in all the earth. The heavens declare your greatness. The oceans cry out to you. The mountains, they bow down before you. So I'll join with the earth and I'll give my praise. Majestic is your name in all the earth. Oh Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. The heavens declare your greatness. The oceans cry out to you. The mountains, they bow down before you. So I'll join with the earth and I'll sing. The heavens declare. The oceans cry out to you. The mountains, they bow down before you. So I'll join with the earth and I'll give my praise to you.
Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed? Welcome you here today to First Baptist Alcoa. It's good to see everybody this morning. Want to take a little bit of time to welcome our guests here. If you're a first-time guest, there's a little card in the pew in front of you, and we'd like for you to fill that card out and put it in the offering plate, and we'd love to deliver you a little gift just to show you our appreciation for being here with us. Let's have a little bit of time of greeting this morning. So everybody go around, find somebody that you don't know this morning and shake their hand and hug a neck this morning.
Died to take our curse.
Your Holy Spirit.
Keep in mind your omniscience, that in all of our financial issues that you know all, oh God, but also we want to keep in mind that you knew all of our sins. You knew every single one, but still you came as a man, and that's why we bow at the cross, oh God, because you knew every single one of our sins, but you decided not to punish us, but to punish your son and to cast our sins into the sea. We thank you for that. I pray our giving can reflect that. In your name, Jesus, amen.
Thank you. while the heavens are filled, as the rocks and the stones take my place.
When I remember his mercies, consider his grace that saved me out of my sin. My hands go in motion, my heart leaps within, my lips help me praise him again.
Beautiful song that has a message that we bless the Lord at all times. And I want you to turn, if you will, and thank you so much for your leadership through worship and praise. And you know, we're all one big praise team. Did you know that? They're not performers. They're not actors. They're leading us in worship. We're all one big praise team. You say, but I haven't joined that team. No, we've joined the body of Christ. And when you join the body of Christ, we're one big praise team. So think about that when you're singing. Your singing makes a difference. Even if you don't know how to sing, you can still sing because joy comes from the heart. All right, now, we're in the fifth church. Last week, fifth church in the book of Revelation, there are seven churches. We're talking about seven habits of highly effective churches. And so there are some things that we see Jesus commending in these churches, and there are some things we see Jesus correcting in these churches. There's really not one good thing he's going to say about this church today, because it's dead. I mean, it's one thing for you and I to say, well, I think this is a dead church. I mean, we've all been to churches before when we walked in and we said, this place is dead. And we have called a spade and said, I believe that this church is dead. Maybe you were on vacation and you visited a church and you went in and you said, this church is dead. Now, it's one thing for us to voice our opinion about what is dead, but when Jesus calls a church dead, it's dead. It is dead. Now, you say, how could this speak to us today? Because 3,500 American churches in this nation close their doors every year. I told you a few weeks ago, 800 Southern Baptist churches close their doors every year. That's why there's all these new church starts. We have to have 800 new church starts to keep up with the 800 churches that are closing their doors. 3,500 churches in America shut their doors and put a for sale sign on them. Now listen, it can happen to any church. It can happen to this church. We are not a dead church. I'm thankful. I look around. I see children. I see young families. I see median age, and I see those that are seasoned. Thank you. And so we have a good mix here. But if we're not careful, this word is to us today, because he's speaking to saved people, and he says, you're going through the motions. You're all about your reputation. You're all about your name. You're a church that is dead. And when Jesus calls you dead, you better make sure you hear what he's saying. So Revelation chapter 3, verses 1 through 6. Revelation chapter 3, verses 1 through 6. I'll ask you to stand out of honor and respect of God's word. And let us hear, Lord, what this church that is dead, what you told them. He gives them some counsel. These things says he who has the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. I know your works, that you have a name, that you are alive, but you are dead. Be watchful and strengthen the things which remain that are ready to die, for I have found your work, I have not found your works perfect before God. Remember, therefore, how you have received and heard. Hold fast and repent. Therefore, if you will not watch, I will come upon you as a thief, and you will not know what hour I will come upon you. You have a few names, even in Sardis, who have not defiled their garments, and they shall walk with me in white, for they are worthy. He who overcomes shall be clothed in white garments, and I will not blot out his name from the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Father, we bow before you. What beautiful music, what beautiful worship, what beautiful songs. But those songs that seem to be so alive must be alive in the hearts of your people, or else we're dead. The songs have got to be more than songs. They've got to be a lifestyle. And so my prayer is, Lord, that we may even tune out this morning because we say, well, this is not a dead church, and we would be accurate to say that. But if we're not careful and don't heed this warning, we can become a statistic just like anybody else. And so, Father, I pray that you'd wake us up. That's what the scripture says, that you told this church to wake up, be watchful. And I pray that we would be watchful. Lord, as we look at this church, I pray that you would give us ears to hear, eyes to see, and a heart that's open to make adjustments. This is the fifth church, and in every church you told them to repent. You never told them to reform. You never told them to rededicate. You never told them to try harder. You never told them to get more members. You never told them to give more money. You never told them to go to class more. You told them to repent. And repentance is a change of mind and a change of direction and a change of heart. So let us repent today as your church. Anything that's out of kilter, anything that's offline today, that you, by the power of the Holy Spirit, would reveal it to hearts and lives. In Jesus' name. Amen. So this church is the church of Sardis. So we would call the members sardines. That's the best I can tell. And so this is a church that was good in name only. They had a reputation. They were hardworking. They had a great reputation out there among the people. In fact, let me tell you a little bit about Sardis. Sardis was a city that was located on an acropolis. It was about 1,500 feet up on a hill. The temple of the false god Artemis, the temple of Artemis was worshipped there. They were worshiping Artemis. It was a very big trade city. For a real estate agent, it would be saying location, location, location. This city was located in a place where people came and people went. It was a great place for business, the clothing business. Dye, that's what the city was known for, Sardis. But if you would go to Sardis today, it's not called Sardis anymore. It's called Sart, S-A-R-T. And there's no church there. There's a few people that are there, but it's basically dead. Now, when you think about a dead church, you have to understand that Jesus knew all about this church. Let me give you a little bit more information about Sardis. 7 miles outside the city was a place where there were hundreds and hundreds of burial grounds. They would bury hundreds of people. They would just stack people. It was called the Thousand Hills on the city, a cemetery of a thousand hills, and they understood death all the time. Death was always in their face, so they had hundreds of burial grounds, a hill called the Thousand Hills of a cemetery. So they knew when Jesus was speaking of death, they knew exactly what he was talking about. He was talking about death. So death was all around them. And then Jesus says, not only is there death in this city, but there's death in this church. This church somehow has gotten away from its mission, has gotten away from what it's supposed to be about. And he comes back to them and he tells them, you think you're alive. You think your reputation in the community is good. Oh, you're doing a lot of things in the community. You're doing a lot of things at the church. You're busy, 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 busy. And your location, location, location. You're placed in a prominent area, but you're dead. You are dead. What an indictment for Jesus to tell a church that they're dead. Now, there was a story, you've probably heard this, about a pastor who In the middle of the night, his church caught on fire, and he was notified, and he went over to the church, and he was looking at the church, and the church was just burning, and firefighters were fighting, and this neighbor of his that he had invited to church many, many times never came to church, and yet that neighbor stood right by that pastor, and the pastor looked at that neighbor and said, I have asked you to come to our church so many times, and he says, why haven't you come? He says, because this is the first time this church has ever been on fire. Now, you think about that, and you'll get it while you're eating Lee's chicken today. Okay, that was supposed to be funny. Now, let me try another one, because I had two illustrations in my mind. Let me tell you how this church was. We've had some beautiful snow, and everybody's yard looked good. Your yard looked good with the snow. But you have some of you have ugly yards. You have dirt and moss and bare spots. But I want to tell you what, when you drive through the neighborhood, when we had this beautiful snow, everybody's yard was covered with snow. And I'm telling you, it was beautiful. But guess what? It didn't last. On the outside, there was snow. On the outside of this church, it all looked pure. It all looked white. But when it all burned off, Jesus has an ability to take and look at what we see, and he goes much deeper. And when the snow melts off, he claims that this church is dead. Would you want to invest in a church that is dead? Why do people stay in a dead church? Well, Jesus tells us here. Look at the specifics of this passage, and I'll give it to you. He says this in verse 1. And remember, the pastor would be the one who would read the letter to the church. He would read it to churches back in ancient days. And it says here, these things says he who has the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. So the seven spirits would be, if you go to Isaiah chapter 11, verse 2, it talks about the Messiah, it talks about the Holy Spirit, and we won't turn there for the sake of time. You can just write that down. But basically, these things he says who has the seven spirits in reference to the Holy Spirit. So the idea is the Holy Spirit, if you've ever been to an airport before, when you trust Christ as your Savior, you have the power of the Holy Spirit. You can walk with your bags in your luggage at an airport, or you can get on what is called a moving sidewalk. You can move much faster. You can walk the same pace, but there's something underneath you. A moving sidewalk takes you further and faster as you walk in a way that you have always walked. So the idea is when the Holy Spirit comes into our life, he is like a moving sidewalk. He empowers us. He's before us. He's beside us. He's in us. He's around us. He's everywhere. He's the power, the Bible says. He leads us into all truth. And the idea is that it says here's what it says here. These things says he who has the seven spirits of God. What this church needed was the fullness of the Spirit of God. Ephesians says, be filled with the Holy Spirit. In the present tense, be continually filled with the Holy Spirit. So the idea is, and it says, he who has the seven spirits of God. It's not that the Holy Spirit is seven. It's talking about the seven spirits of God. Look at Isaiah 11, 2. And the seven stars. That's the pastor. That's the teacher. Okay? And here's what he says. Here's what he says to a dead church. I know your works. Oh, you're busy. You're working, man. You are working hard. You are doing a lot of good things. You have a lot of programs. You have a form of worship, but the heart of worship is absent. You have a lot of stuff that people come to, but your heart is far from me. That's what he's saying. Hey, I know your works. See, a lot of people mess around with works. They think works is synonymous with salvation, and it's not. You see, we don't work for our salvation. We work in our salvation. But this was a church that was busy. This was a church that would be known to have a reputation by other people to be a fairly busybody church. They had location, location, location. And then he says that you have a name, that you're alive. So they even thought they were alive. The community thought they were alive. The people thought they were alive. But here's what Jesus said in verse 1, but you're dead. You are dead. You're lifeless. You're void of life from me. You are a dead church. That's what he's saying to the church. What an indictment to put a for sale sign out in front of a church because a church is dead. And then here's what he does. He gives a prescription for this dead church. He's going to give several points here that I'm going to try to bring out for us. But the first thing he says to this dead church is, wake up. I want to say that to some of you right now who are starting to doze. Wake up. Wake up. That's what he says. He says, wake up. And so a doctor gives a prescription for somebody to get well. I remember somebody getting a prescription, and they went back to the doctor, and they told the doctor, they said, I do not feel any better than when I came to see you a month ago. And the doctor said, well, did you follow the instructions on the medicine, on the bottle? And they said, yes. It says, keep tightly closed. And they did. They kept it tightly closed. He said, read further. Well, this church, watch this, kept tightly closed. They kept the Word of God closed. And Jesus' first words to them are, be watchful, wake up. Think about this. I think what he's telling First Baptist Alcoa this morning, you better be watchful, you better wake up. Last week he told us about sexual immorality in the church. Do I need to give you any examples? Did you have some examples this week about sexual immorality? If you watch the Grammys, was that not sick? Oh, you say, oh, you watched it? Oh, I did just a little bit because I wanted to prove my point. Oh, they had all kinds of marriages during a song. Male, male, female, female, male, female, sexual. It's everywhere. And Jesus said, I want this church to be pure. Listen, where there's purity, there's power. Where there's purity, there's power. When there's purity in the song and the people singing the songs, there's power. When there's purity in the pulpit, there's power. When there's purity in the pew, there's power. And Jesus is all interested about power. He's wanting to give power and grace to a church that is dead. And he says, be watchful, wake up. I wonder if there's somebody in the fourth quarter of their life today. I wonder if some of you are in the bottom of the ninth inning and you don't have much time, and Jesus is going to say to you, wake up as a grandfather, wake up as a husband, wake up as a mother. Those children are going to put the tassel on this side and they're going to be gone. Wake up, church, wake up, wake up. We need to wake up as a church. Did you notice how I said we? We need to wake up. We need to wake up and say, Lord, it's possible that we could be dead today. It's possible that we could be on the verge of moving toward death. And you give us a word to wake up, wake up. We have got to wake up in America as the church, because churches all across America are closing their doors. And Jesus gives a prescription for waking up. He says, be watchful. Have you ever been on a long trip in an airplane? You've had several connecting flights, and you're just like jet lag, you're tired. Jeremy can relate to this. Mike, others of you that have been on mission trips, our missionaries that'll speak at the end. You know, you can think about jet lag, and you know, sometimes, I don't know, for me, I run really good, but buddy, when I fade, I fade. See, you don't know that about me. I can just drop out. I mean, you know, if you're at the airport and you've been up since early in the morning and it's about 3 p.m, you may get a triple espresso, right? And that's only going to shoot you up to drop you down. And then later you can find yourself, when you're waiting for your connecting flight, you got drool running out of your mouth. I've seen people in the airport, they got drool running out of their mouth. Yeah, that's like some of you right now. You're going, help prop me up, bobblehead, bobblehead. Be watchful, wake up. What Jesus is saying to this church is, you've got jet lag. You remember in the scripture when Jesus went, Peter, James, and John, they were bobbling, they were starting to go, they were drooling. He said, you can't stay with me 1 hour. Listen, if it can happen to Peter, James, and John, it can happen to me. If it can happen to Peter, James, and John, it can happen to you. If it can happen to Peter, James, and John, it can happen to this church. We can fall asleep at the wheel and start drooling. And Jesus said, you're dead. We better wake up. We better wake up. For those of you that are parents, grandparents, wake up. Wake up. There are little lives that are looking to us. Sometimes you got to turn off the iPad. Sometimes you got to turn off the TV, drop the remote control, and look at your family and speak. Because there's times I can get involved in TV, and I can get involved on my iPad, and we can be thinking, oh, but look, sometimes the people around us need us to look. Wake up, wake up. I think God is saying, be watchful, be wakeful here. Jesus is saying, you know, there are some of you that goof off when reading scripture, and the word to you today would be watchful. You goof off when you're singing, be watchful. He's talking to a church that is dead. And here's the prescription. He says, be watchful, number one. Number two, he says, strengthen the things which remain. In other words, you're almost there, buddy. You are heading down a slippery slope. Strengthen the things which are ahead, which remain. So the idea is, there's some life in you. You're dead, but there's some life. There's not much time. You're going to die. You're going to die off. There's going to be a for sale sign. And then he says, strengthen. Let me give you the word strengthen. It means to stabilize that which is frail. That's what the word strengthen means. So the idea would be this. We need to go to the gym. We need to strengthen those things that remain. Strengthen those things in the Bible study. Strengthen those things instead of having a playful life, have a prayer life. Strengthen the things that remain. Pray for your children. Pray for your church. Continue to pray for our search team. Continue to pray. Strengthen those things, because the tendency is we fall asleep at the wheel. And he says, strengthen, stabilize those things. You've all seen it in movies when someone's about to die. Someone will grab the person and say, stay with me, don't you die. That's what Jesus is saying to the church. Stay with me, don't you die, don't you nod off and go to sleep. Strengthen the things, look at the text, which remain. So this was a church that was inoffensive. There's no persecution in this church because they have no message. They're playing games. They're playing religious games. They have a name only in the community. They don't have any power. They're dead. This church was never faced with persecution because they were inoffensive. They were not offensive with their message. They were not on the offense. They were inoffensive. And he says, strengthen those things which remain, because you're ready, look at this, to die. For I have not, look at verse 1. I'm still in 1. There's a lot here in this message. For I have not found your works perfect before God. He's talking about the church. What he's saying is, the church, you're not mature. You're not complete. You're not purposeful. Let me give you a threefold purpose of the church. There's a lot of ways you can cut this, slice this pie, but let me give you three. It's upward, it's inward, and it's outward. Just that simple. It's upward, it's inward, and it's outward. Let me give you three E's. It's about the church. This church wasn't found faithful in what they were doing. Their works weren't perfect before God, and perfect does not mean perfection. Perfect means maturity. They weren't maturing. They weren't growing. They were dead. So the threefold purpose of the church: upward, inward, and outward. Here's upward. Upward is exaltation of God. Inward is the edification of the saints. And third, outward is the evangelization of the lost. This church had lost it. They were dead. They weren't focusing. And Jesus said, you're about to die. So whatever it is that we do, we got to focus on three E's, if you want to put it that way. We can put it in three C's, three B's, three A's, whatever. But we focus on exaltation, edification of the saints. And the third thing is evangelization of the lost. Now, Chuck Swindoll, I borrowed this from him. He gives five marks of a dead church. I want to give them to you today. A dead church, number one, worships its past. Here's what a dead church does. It talks about former pastors. If you go to a dead church today, they'll talk about the glory days of how it used to be. Former pastors, former staff members, former days. A church that's dead talks about its past. Now listen, anything that's living is alive. But a dead church is always focused on the past. They're always talking about the past. They're always bringing up names from the past rather than looking at the present and marking toward the future. Now, there's nothing wrong to acknowledge the past, but you cannot live in the past as a Christian. You cannot live in the past as a church. You have to move forward. And Chuck Swindoll, I think, rightly shares the marks of a dead church. Number one, they live in the past. Number two, they're inflexible and resistant to change. They're inflexible and resistant to change. Do you know any churches like that? You see, we should be inflexible on those. We should be flexible on those. Inflexible on those things that are flexible, and flexible on those things that are inflexible. Let me see if I can. I don't know if it came out right, but let me see if I can explain. Oh boy. Okay. Now, here's some things I'm not inflexible on, and come up close, and you'll already know this about me. When we come to worship, we're going to exalt God. I'm inflexible on that. When we come to church, we're going to study God's word. I'm inflexible on that. You may come to me and say, I have a different idea of what church is. Well, I'm inflexible on that. Don't even come to me. You can go to another church that plays games or does something. But when we come to church, I'm inflexible on this. And you should be inflexible as well. But things I am flexible on is methodology. Methodology, how we do what we do. There are a lot of things today that we can do better. In a church, there are some horses that need to be unsaddled and let go. We've been doing this forever, and they need to be unsaddled and let go. In some churches, there are horses that need to be shot. I'm serious. Okay, so which horses are we going to unsaddle? And, well, let's let the Lord lead us. But there are some horses that just need to be shot. So Chuck Swindoll rightfully shares, and I believe this church was probably there, they're inflexible and resistant to change. Like, for example, if you tell me today, you know what? I just think we ought to watch a movie. Someone might come to me before the service, I think we ought to watch Toy Story 2. Well, and somebody else may come, I think Men in Black 3. Listen, if you want to go see a movie, go see a movie, but we're not doing a movie here. Now, style of music, we can be flexible on. We can be flexible. Some people say, well, like a scream. You know, I've heard people not here, not at this church. Please hear me. I say it clearly, not here. But I've been to churches because the screens came out in the 1990s, about the 1990s somewhere. Churches had screens. And then pastors were preaching, and we called it Image Mag, and they'd put a pastor on the screen. And I remember one time in a church that I was at, a lady came up and said, I tell you what, I come to church, and I didn't come to church to watch TV. That's how she said it. I just stood there. I wasn't even the senior pastor, so this is good. I just stood there. And she says, I can watch TV at home. And can I tell you, that lady is still in the same church. And guess what? There's still a screen there. She's probably watching it today. Listen, things change. Technology changes. There's nothing sinful on a screen. Some churches today, church starts, they pipe in a pastor at their main campus, and they do it to a video at another campus. Nothing wrong with that. That's technology. That's getting the word out. Isn't the most important thing that we get the word of God to people? Absolutely. So there are some people that are inflexible and resistant to change. Third mark of a dead church. Chuck Swindoll. Lazy leadership and carnal Christians. Lazy leadership. There's no place for laziness in the body of Christ. There's no place for lazy Christians. And listen, here's what was happening in Sardis with the Sardines, that these people were becoming lazy. They were coming lethargic, they were coming apathetic, and they were becoming passive, and Jesus said, you're dead. And so the idea was that there's no room for lazy leadership. You cannot be lazy and be in the Christian life and be in the Christian world and be in the Christian war. There's no room for laziness. There's no room for carnal Christians. So that's a third mark of a dead church. Number four, a church that is dead neglects youth. Thank God we don't do that here, right? We don't do that here. Listen, the lifeblood of our church, if you come on Wednesday night, we have over 200 people here under the age of 18, 200 children, students. For a church our size, that's pretty monumental. Because this church made a decision a long time ago, and I'm simply carrying on the vision of the pastors before me, that we will never neglect students, we will never neglect children in this church, because if we do, we will die. We will put a for sale sign out in the front, and we will die. Thank the Lord. If you're an older person today, or seasoned, excuse me, if you're seasoned, and you're sitting next to a young person, you ought to thank God you have that young person sitting next to you. You agree with me? You better believe it. Because I'm telling you, there are a lot of churches, if you go, they're all older people. They're all seasoned. They're all there. The young families don't come. The youth don't come. The children don't come. Because really, in a way, that church at some point has decided not to invest in teenagers and not to invest in students. Number five, here's the last one. Be careful. It lacks evangelistic zeal and missions. A church that is dead lacks evangelistic zeal and missions. And thank God here that we understand that missions is not what you do. Missions is who you are. We got missionaries going out all over. You'll hear from some today that are our guests. So here in this verse 2, here's what it says. You're about ready to die. I have found your works before God. I have not found your works before God. So this was a church that was dead. This was a church that was dying. And it's so important that we understand that Jesus is speaking this to them. Now look at verse number three. Let me get a little water here. Get me through. Verse number three. Here we go. Here's how you come back. Here's a prescription. He not only said be watchful, and not only did he say be strengthened, but he tells you to remember. Remember, here's what he says. Remember, therefore, how you have received and heard. He gives a corrective. He's talking about a love affair. He's talking about remember when you got saved. Remember the passion that you had. Remember how excited you were when you first came to know Jesus. You know, if you come to our church, and if I stayed on the stage,
you would notice there's a cross right there. If you looked where I'm looking across the balcony, there's a cross on the backside. There are a lot of churches that have left the teaching of the cross, the place where Jesus died, and they're nothing but a museum and a monument to the past. But as long as you keep the cross first and foremost, he says, remember the cross, remember your salvation, remember the price that was paid for you. That's what he says in verse 3, and the word in the Greek is keep on remembering. Don't you ever forget. You know, it's always a challenge for us when we do the Lord's Supper. When do we do it? Because, you know, if we do it on a Sunday night, you know how many people we'll have? 50, maybe. Could you imagine doing the Lord's Supper and remembering the blood that was shed on Calvary's cross for you, and 50 people come back and say, oh, okay, thank you very much. Think about that. Have we as a church, is it possible that we are heading toward deadness because we have forgotten how good our God is? He tells this church, remember 9/11. I was not here, but I'm going to tell you the church I was at, we had three services. We had 10, we could fit about 2,500 in each service, and we had at least 2,700 in each service. On 9/11, do you know what? It was packed here too, wasn't it? Pretty close. Guarantee it was pretty full. churches all across America were packed that day. Then you take the next week, they were still pretty full, but not as full. Go to week 3 or 4, guess what? Just back to normal. Because we forget. We've got to go back and remember. Jesus is telling this church, remember, and keep on remembering the cross. Keep on remembering your salvation. Remembering is not just thinking. Remembering is doing. Now look at the next thing. He says, remember therefore how you have received and heard. Hold fast. The word hold fast means to keep. What have you received? Everything. You've received everything from him. So remember that. And then he says, repent. How many times is he going to say repent? This is the fifth time to the church he says repent. Can I tell you what he's saying to our church? Repent. If you're saved, I want you to say I'm saved. Then he tells you repent. He's telling this to save people. Repent. 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 Wake up. Be strengthened. Hold fast. And repent. Repent. Therefore, next part of verse 3, therefore if you will not watch, I will come upon you as a thief, and you will not know the hour I will come upon you. I don't think he's talking about the coming of the Lord there. I think he's talking about the judgment, that the Lord's going to pounce on you. The idea is that this church is supposed to be pure. This church is supposed to have power. And he says, as a thief, I will come upon you as a thief. Now, when a thief is going to steal something, they don't call you at 2:15 and say, I'm going to be there at 2:30. A thief doesn't do that. A thief doesn't say, you know what? I'm going to give you a little heads up, because if they did, you know who we'd call? We'd have the police over there. We'd have the National Guard and the Navy SEALs to meet them if they came and named the time. But this thief, he says, he's coming like a thief in the night. And so that's the Lord's judgment to a quickening church that is just involved in the motions, just involved in meetings, just involved in programs, no power, no purity, just going through the motions. He said, be careful, because I'm coming to pounce. I'm coming to pounce. Look at this, verse 4. Verse 3, I'm sorry, that was verse 2 still. Or verse 3. Verse 4, here we go. Little last part. You have a few names. Verse 4. There's a remnant in every church. You have a few names, even in Sardis, who have not defiled their garments. And they shall walk with me in white, for they are worthy. Now this gets good. Let me read this again, and then we'll unpack it here. He says, you have a few names. Even in Sardis, who have not defiled their garments, and they walk with me in white, for they are worthy. You see, in every church, there's always a remnant of people. There's a remnant here. There's a remnant in every church. There's always a remnant. You're always looking for the core. You're always looking for the remnant, the base, to grow stronger and to grow deeper. There's a remnant. So there were some people here, stay with me, there were some people here who didn't leave this church. They stayed. It was dead, and they stayed. You know, there are good reasons to leave a church, but problems is never one. People leave churches because churches have problems. Can I tell you this? This is not a perfect church, but this is a good church. And you're not a perfect person, but you're a good person. What I have found, because I've left churches before, I've gone to different churches, I have found sometimes when I leave someplace, guess what? I follow myself to the next place. Seriously. Listen, if God leads you to leave this place, then you need to leave. But if you're leaving because there's some sort of problem or there's some sort of situation, you shouldn't leave because of that. You should leave because God tells you to leave, because the remnant is always growing stronger, and the remnant says, we'll stay there and we'll be pure and we'll ask God to move us in power, in His power, in His grace. Because what I have found in my own personal life, it must be somewhere in Proverbs, wherever I go, there I is. What he says. But look here in this text. There are a few names. Even in Sardis, who have not defiled their garments. Do you know what Sardis was? It's a clothing town. Not only did they know when he was speaking to this dead church, because they had mountains and mountains of burials, and a city on a cemetery city on the hill of Artemis, but this church was known for its clothing dye. And so when he was talking about their garments, even in Sardis, who have not defiled their garments, the people in Sardis who would even go worship these false gods, they would not let them come in with any kind of soiled garment. They made them come in to worship a false god with a clean garment. Now, let's make the application here. Now, all this beautiful white snow that we've had, all this beautiful white snow. I've got a beautiful dog. He's black and white. He's got a beautiful white collar and a white speck on his ear, and he's got beautiful white feet. And he went out on this pure driven snow, and I looked at him and his hair looked yellow. I said, did you dip him, Leslie, in canola oil? What happened to the dog? Well, here's what happened to the dog. The dog, who thought he was white, really wasn't that white when it's put against the purity of the snow. And when we put our lives against the purity of the Lord Jesus Christ, we look discolored. But when we put our faith in Jesus Christ, He washes us by His blood and makes us white as snow. And Jesus said, in this church, there are some people who don't have a defiled garment. They're pure. And listen to me, where there's purity, there is power. And where there's power, there is ministry. And where there's ministry, there is missions. And Jesus said to this church, there are a few who are left that understand not defiling a garment. Now also, in Rome, they would wear a white toga, which would be representative of triumph and purity and acceptability. So you see here, notice what he says. He says, not only that, they didn't have defiled garments, and they shall walk with me in white. They shall walk with me in white. You know, there'll be a day, it talks about later on in Revelation, we'll be walking with white garments, the purity representing the one who came and died for us and saved us and gave us purity. All right? So he says, they are worthy. And then he says, there's a reward here. Look at this, verse 5. He who overcomes shall be clothed in white garments. Okay, there it is again. They would understand that in Sardis. And I will not blot out of his name from the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before the angels. Now, this is important, because a lot of people will take this passage and they'll say, see there, you can lose your salvation. You can forfeit your salvation. Now listen, I can give you other texts to go to if you want to challenge that area. I'll give you a better text to go to. Now, I don't believe the Bible teaches you can lose your salvation, but a lot of people say, well, right here, he says, I will not. That has to do with salvation, and that has to do with the forfeiture of salvation. Let me explain to you the book of life. When we're born, our name goes into a book. Every person in this world that Jesus died for, which is all, okay, their names are in a book. When you are born earthly in this earth and in this life, your name goes into a book, the book of life. But if you or me or anybody goes through this life and chooses to reject the Lord Jesus Christ, which people do, then when you die, then your name is going to be taken out of the book of life. That's what it says here. He says, I will not blot his name out of the book of life. So the idea is that Jesus died for the sins of the whole world, and everybody that he died for, their name is in the book of life. You can look at Revelation chapter 20. It talks about, can refer to this as a book of remembrance, the Lamb's book of life, but there's a book. There is a book. Now watch this. In Sardis, they had a registry, and every person that lived in that city was in that registry. And when you died, your name was taken out of that registry because you're dead. You're not among the living anymore. You're dead. Now, let me tell you something about this book. When you die, if you have trusted Jesus Christ as your Savior and you die, he does not erase your name. You got it? He does not erase your name because your name is in there and you have trusted in the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and you are an overcomer, verse 5. And do you know King David? Let me tell you what King David said. Turn to Psalm 69, verse 28. Psalm 69, verse 28. Here's what he says. Psalm 69, verse 28. So he's talking about even King David. He's talking about the book. And he's talking about being blotted out of the book. Now, I want you to hear me in closing because you're going to miss this, and it's very important that you understand this. For those who have trusted Jesus Christ as their Savior, your name is in the book. Your name is in the registry. If you're on a church registry, if your name is in our computer because you attended this church, you will not go to heaven because you're faithful in attendance at this church. You only go to heaven when you trust Jesus Christ and his finished work on the cross for your salvation and the resurrection power that he gives you. Verse 28 of 69. Here's what King David said. Let them, that's the bad guys, look at this. Let them be blotted out of the book of the living. So there's a book of the living. Let them be blotted out of the book of the living and not be written with the righteous. Okay, let's read it again. You could find many other references to this, but I'm giving you one. Let them, the bad guys, be blotted out of the book of the living. There's a book on the living, book of life, and not be written with the righteous. You know what he's saying? Who's this? Who? People, who gets to heaven? People who live righteous lives? No. People who have right standing with God. Not people who have right living. Right living doesn't get you into heaven. Right living doesn't get you into the book of life. Right standing gets you in the book of life. And right standing is when you trust in Jesus Christ as your Savior. I want to ask you very pointedly this morning, are you dead in your trespasses and sins? Or has there been a time where you have trusted Jesus for your salvation? You see, King David even knew in Psalm 69, 28, now go back to the book of life in Revelation. So when we die, when you die, whenever your last day is, whenever my last day is, my name is in the book, not because of right living, it's because of my right standing, because I've trusted Jesus Christ as my Savior. When I die, he's not going to erase my name from the book of life. Those people whose name is going to be erased are those people who have rejected the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior. Jesus gives us a free will to choose him, and if you choose to reject him, my dear friend, you will split hell wide open. But you had a chance today to receive him. You can change course. Man, you can repent. Man, we as a church can repent. We can repent of the way we live. We can repent of the way we're going. We can say, Lord, have mercy on us and lead us to righteousness and truth. Strengthen us. Let us be watchful. We don't want to let this happen to us. Remember, hold fast and repent. Then he says here, look at this, at the last part of verse 5. And he says, I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. You know what that's saying? Jesus is going to, he's going to stand up for us one day. He's going to say to the Father, as we stand before the Father, he's going to say to, I got Freeman. I got him. He trusted me. He trusted me with his life. He wasn't perfect. He wasn't even that great of a person. But I lived in him, and he trusted me. He bowed, as we sang that song early, and bow my knees before the cross. I'm telling you, I have bowed my knees before the cross, and I'm telling you, all of the ground at the foot of the cross is level. I don't care if you're a doctor, a lawyer, a plumber. plumber, an educator. We all come to faith in Jesus Christ the same way. And if you have never trusted Jesus Christ today, you can have your name in the book of life, never to be erased anymore, because Jesus can come into your heart as a teenager, as a child, as an adult today, and save you forever. Forever. Jesus said, hey, angels, Father, I'm confessing him before you. You know, think about this. You know, sometimes we blow opportunities to witness. God gives us another opportunity. But let's just say one day you're in a group and someone's saying, well, I don't believe in Jesus Christ, and I don't believe in God, and I don't believe in salvation, and I don't believe in heaven. And you're standing there, and you're a Christian, and they come around to you, and they say, what do you think? And you go, man, I don't like to get into politics, and I don't like to really get into religion that much. Can I tell you something? At that moment, you've denied the Lord because you didn't confess him. I didn't say you weren't going to heaven, but that's a good test. When you have the opportunity that comes right before you and the platform is set for you and me to speak, would we confess the Lord? Would we? Because he says here, I'm going to confess you if you learn to confess me. That's what he's saying. The book of life. And then he says this, he who has an ear, I'm closing with this. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Let's do some end time aerobics as we close. If you have an ear, raise your hand. Put it down. Jesus says, hear what I'm saying. You have an ear? Listen to me. I'll close with this story. Jesus sees when the snow melts off, he sees what the church really is. He sees in your life and in my life exactly how things could look really great on the outside. Things can look great on the outside of your marriage. Things can look great as you walk in here, but you could be on the inside, dirty and messy and smelly and just rotten on the inside. My father, we bought when I was growing up, Leslie took a few rides in this boat. It was a boat my father bought. It's called a Bandito boat. Never heard of it before. And we had that boat. It was a nice, sparkly, had some real glisser. It was real glisteny and sparkly and metallic blue and silver and had a black pinstripe on it. We picked it out on the lot, so that's the boat we won. Had a 70-horsepower Evinrude engine on the back. And it's a pretty heavy engine. And we bought this boat, and about 7 years into having this boat, we didn't use it a whole lot. The motor is mounted on a transom, and that transom is supposed to be splashed with fiberglass so that it strengthens. It shouldn't just be wood. But this particular boat that we had was missing the fiberglass right at the back. It had the fiberglass everywhere on the inside, but somewhere where the motor was sitting, where all of the weight was, there was no fiberglass, so there was no strength. And so we were boating one day, and we came back, and we were getting ready for our next trip, and somehow, I don't know if my dad kind of moved the motor, if we moved it as we were strapping on the tarp to it to take it somewhere, but you could hear things just begin to crack. It's just like wood cracking, like this, just cracking. And we looked at it, and then we took our hand, and this beautiful paint, you push your finger in it, it's like rotten wood. It was rotten wood. See, all on the outside where that motor was sitting, it all looked good. It all looked good on the outside, but on the inside, it was really rotten. What Jesus is saying to this dead church is, you may think you look good, but I'm really telling you, you're dead. You're rotten on the inside. If you want to get back on track with me, you need to repent. You need to remember. You need to hold fast because I'm coming like a thief. And so the message to us today, if you need a takeaway, let me tell you this. Here's takeaway number one. We need to change. We need to change. Anything that's living is always changing. Something that's dead, it doesn't ever change. You know, sometimes I do funerals. Well, I do a lot. And then I do weddings that are really like funerals. But for those of you that are considering getting married, and people will ask me, it's happened more than I want to admit. Well, Pastor, how do they look in there? What do you think about how they look? And I just say, they're dead. But then as I'm walking away, I say, that's actually the best they've ever looked. You know what Jesus is saying? As you look into the coffin today, you know, if we were to file by and if we had a service and we had somebody in here, what I would do is take the body out and I would give us for the invitation. I would have all of us come by and we would play some funeral music and we would just put a coffin right here. But at the bottom of that coffin, we'd put a mirror. So when we'd look in, we would see ourselves and Jesus says, you're dead. Is it possible that this church, as great as her future is, as great as God wants to use this church and this people right here in this room, is it possible that we could look in a mirror today and see ourselves and the Lord might pronounce us, you're close or you're dead? He says, repent. Listen, let's repent and go to the well that will never run dry. Would you bow your head with me? Change. Are you willing to change? Are you willing to let the Holy Spirit change you? Are you willing to take introspection? Father, we come thanking you for this church that's dead. Because the message to Sardis is the same message that you have for us. We should be very careful. We should be watchful. We should be strengthened. We should not have a reputation in name only when you call us dead. We should remember, we should hold fast, and we should be strengthened on the inside. Because if our name really is written in that book of life, then we've trusted you as Savior. And when our final day comes, it won't be taken out of there. Like those in ancient history, when they died in a city, their name came off the registry. So my prayer is, Lord, that during this song, that we might reflect on the well that never runs dry, that you're deep and you love us and you see right through the snow to what's really there. And if we're rotten on the inside, you want to put us back together. So I pray you'd save people who are dead in their trespasses and sins and bring them to life. In Jesus' name, amen.
Leave it all behind. Leave it all behind. Leave it all behind, leave it all behind. I have what you need, but you keep on searching. I've done all the work, but you keep on working. When you're running on empty and you can't find the remedy, just come to the well. You can spend your whole life chasing what's missing, but that empty inside, it just ain't gonna listen. When nothing can satisfy and the world leaves you high and dry, just come to the well. How broken, just come as you are. When the last prayer is spoken, just rest in my arms a while, and you'll feel the change, my child, when you come to the well. 'Cause all who thirst will thirst no more, and all who search they will find what their souls long. Now that you're full of love beyond measure, your joy's gonna flow like a stream in the desert. And soon all the world will see that living water is found in me, 'cause you came to the well. And all who thirst will thirst no more. And all who search will find what their souls long for. The world will try, but it can never fail. So leave it all behind and come to the well.
I'm going to ask you to stand, and I'm going to ask you to come to the well. You know, things don't always appear as they seem. Many of you are going to watch the Super Bowl today, and that's fine. But while we're watching the Super Bowl, this is one of the biggest events for human trafficking. This day at the Super Bowl, there have been people flown in from all over that are going to make money on young boys and young girls today and force them to have sex. And it's a big money-making business. It's called human trafficking. Oh, we say the Super Bowl, but let me tell you what's behind the scenes of the Super Bowl. What Jesus is trying to say to us as a church is, I know your church, I know First Baptist Alcoa, but let me tell you what's behind what you see. I see the way things really are. I want us to pray right now, right here on this floor, for children today, that God somehow will protect them, expose this sin-sick stuff that's going on. If you don't know what I'm talking about in human trafficking, just search it. It's real. I want us to pray. And then maybe next year, God may lead some of us to be a part of stopping human trafficking, because it's just not at the Super Bowl. We're a light, and we shine our candle in the darkness. Could we repent of our apathy and passivity today? Could we repent that the Lord possibly might be saying, you're real close to being dead because you're not sensitized to the things I'm sensitive to anymore. You're going to church, going through the motions, doing the stuff, but I can pronounce you dead. I'm going to ask you to join me, if you will, in prayer. This is serious business. And we repent.